are studying at VES. So we have College of Engineering, Arts, Science, Commerce, Polytechnic, Management, Law, and Architecture. And Pharmacy College was started in 2007. So right now we have BPharm, MPharm, and PhD program in Pharmaceutics, Pharmaceutical Chemistry, and MPharm program in Quality Assurance as well. So all our programs are affiliated to University of Mumbai. So really feel good to be your colleague of University of Mumbai, talking on behalf of VES College of Pharmacy. So this college always had a focus to create a good research ecosystem. So with this pursuit, we tried to get actively connected to the industry. We also appointed, or rather invited, Professor Nagarsekar, Mangal Nagarsekar Madam, as our honorary research advisor. And very recently, Ms. Dr. Anil Gandhi, who was earlier working with Rubicon as a director of their innovation center, has also joined us as our advisor. So also, we are trying to have a lot of interactions with the industry, having MOUs with them, conducting a lot of workshops, add-on courses by the industry, and inviting the speakers to conduct such type of seminars, webinars, workshops. So all together has given us good outcome. Very happy to share with all of you that in 2018, we got the Best College Award in the AICT-CII survey of Best Industry-Linked Institution. Our BPharm program is accredited by National Board of Accreditation till 2022. And it has received permanent affiliation of University of Mumbai. We have to go a long way, and our endeavors would be to always work actively and create innovation, entrepreneurship type of ecosystem at the institute level so that many of us get benefited from it. And we also start thinking to become a self-employed person, the entrepreneur, and not just the employee. So today's session has been conceived. In fact, Sita has post-graduated from VES College of Pharmacy, and we were planning to conduct this session for our postgraduate students. But then what we thought is that we have a platform like Google Meet, so why not to keep it open for everybody, so that all the research scholars and whosoever wants to take a benefit of it, this session is open to them. So this is the second live session that we are going to give it to you. And I'm really grateful to Sita for taking up time and did not mind to give one more live repetition for the benefit of all of us. So I'm sure you're going to enjoy this session. There are many tips that you're going to get, and your journey of publication is going to be fruitful. Thank you very much and wish you all the best.
Thank you, Principal Madam. I would like to now give a brief background of the webinar. Writing a research paper requires a great deal of in-depth study of a particular subject. What makes scientific writing more unique is interpretation of the data and crafting the outcome in a structured format. Thus, a right start in the right direction will speed up the writing process and give the right perspective. A little detail of the speaker. So today we have Ms. Sita VG. She is currently pursuing her doctorate degree, PhD in pharmaceutics, from the Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, under the guidance of Professor Dr. Pradeep Bavia. She has published one book chapter, four peer-reviewed research papers, and one research paper in National Journal. She has applied for four Indian patents. Today, she'll be briefing about basics and essentials of good writing, different types of scientific articles, writing a publishable research article, and emphasis on importance of writing style, flow of thoughts, plagiarism check, and referencing software. So with this short background, I will share now the screen. I will request Sita to now share the screen and start with the webinar.
Hello, everybody. Very good afternoon. Thank you very much, ma'am. And thank you, Chaitali, for this initiative and for the introduction. So it's glad to be a part and be back connected with my alma mater, where I finished my post-graduation studies. And I'm very happy to take this opportunity to connect with the postgraduate students and the other participants. So I will just share my presentation now. Just a kind request to everybody. I would really appreciate if everybody could mute their audio, because we have a large participants of around 100 people at the moment, so that there is no disturbance. And if at because of any technical glitches there is some slowing down of sharing, so please keep patience and please ensure all the time that your video and audio is off. So thank you very much. We will start with the presentation now. Chaitali, again, like the previous session, I would be requiring your help intermittently if everything is going smooth or no.
Sure, I'll let you know.
Yeah. Okay, so we talk today about the best practices in scientific writing. My name is Sita, as Chaitali has already introduced. So we know that along with a good research practice, good laboratory practice, however important, however novel, however good our research is, it doesn't effectively come out to the scientific community unless you write it in the best possible, effective and scientific way. So that's why we are today, and I hope that this would motivate you all a little bit to spend the remaining days of quarantine to maybe start your habit in scientific writing. So this is going to be the agenda of the webinar today, which we are going to touch point by point. So we start with what is scientific writing. Scientific writing is basically a technical form of writing. This would either be to document the scientific results or to communicate the scientific information to other scientists. This would ensure wider dissemination of knowledge and advance understanding in a particular field. For budding scientists like us, it is also an entry point into the scientific fraternity. Now, we have read so many scientific documents, so it is essential for us to know the classification of scientific documents. The different types of scientific documents would be primary literature. Primary literature are essentially those literature which have a first-hand information of the results of the scientists. So when you say first-hand information, it is basically maybe a research article, maybe a short proceeding, a poster presentation, an expert opinion, or for that matter, even a doctoral thesis or a patent. Now we come to the secondary literature, which is essentially a compilation of these primary literature. So that would be a review article or a journal or different books. Then we have tertiary literature, which would be a major compilation of different segments, different arenas of knowledge that would cater to a wider population. So here we know the primary literature, secondary and the tertiary literature. Now we come towards effective writing. Whatever, however scientific writing we have to do, the most important part is how we reproduce it. How do we write it effectively such that it reaches a wider audience? So we look at the five main essentials of effective writing. Now that I'm going to touch upon in this presentation, this may be a little general, or this may be something that you already know. But what is important is how well do you implement this into your own manuscript. And that is why we have gathered here for to brush up all those knowledge and to ensure that you implement it while you are scientifically writing it. So the effective writing has five main essential points. The first one would be a central idea. The central idea that you are planning to write on must be clear. It must be convincing and powerful. And the data that support should reinstate your central idea. The second part of the effective writing would be organization. You need to ensure that the flow that your entire manuscript is organized in a particular way that would be logical and sequential when a reader reads it. There has to be clear transition between the ideas, like from the start of the page to the end of the page. If I'm going to drift between ideas, I need to ensure that there is a smooth transition. There is an explanation, there is a smooth transition from one idea to the next idea. And of course, there has to be an effective conclusion. The third part of effective writing would be supporting material. So the supporting material, like the references and the ample examples, must repeatedly clarify and reinstate the central idea that we are trying to portray in our manuscript. The fourth and the most effective component of effective writing would be expression and word choice. Now, we know that everybody has different way of expressing it. Everybody has different word choice. No matter how what a person writes, there has to be a clear and a conscious word choice, which would be simple and which would not communicate any ambiguity in their scientific writing. Because this has to cater to a wider population down the years. There is no specific limit up to what year you are going to read that. So even 10 years down the line, if somebody is going to read it, you have to ensure that your language is simple and unambiguous. And the last part of effective writing would be the overall presentation, the overall look and feel of the article, which includes spellings, which includes grammar, punctuation marks, maybe formatting, and the overall look, and correct words to intend the proper meaning. Now, we are going to touch upon a lot of examples in the coming slides. So apart from effective writing, what we also need to focus is good writing. Now, again, when I say this, good writing is general, is everybody knows this. In fact, when I'm writing to sit, not just a scientific paper, maybe even a WhatsApp text, I have to ensure that these things are in place, so that I effectively and essentially communicate well. We start with, like, the written communication is very different from an oral communication or personal writing. So if I have to take up an example and maybe tell my colleague that, hey, you have to add 2 ml of ethanol and maybe mix it well and see how much time you get a clear solution. But when I'm writing it in a written way, it cannot be the same. I cannot be writing it in the same format. So maybe when I'm writing it, it needs to follow a particular scientific tone. It needs to have a uniform writing style throughout my manuscript, pertaining to the past tense or a present tense, pertaining to the voice that is active or passive voice. So the same example while writing, it would be more convenient and more appropriate scientifically if I write by saying that 2 ml of additional solvent was added to the reaction mixture. Similarly, it would make more sense scientifically when I write that the data were analyzed or when I write that the experiment was carried out in a sterile environment. The writing should also be concise and formal. It should be impartial and it should be objective in language. So when I say objective language, that means it needs to have all these specific parameters that you use to conduct your research work. So that could be the temperature, the reaction conditions, the humidity, maybe the time for which you carry out the reaction, the stirring speed. So here in an objective language, I would be writing that the mixture was centrifuged at 10,000 RPM for 10 minutes. So this makes my procedure absolutely clear to the scientific community. Then we come to the language that we must use. It must be simple enough for the students to understand, because at some point I was also a student, and if I would have read a very hi-fi language research paper, maybe I would have thought that it is beyond my capacity and I would have just left it out, though I have interest in that particular area. So the writing essentially should be simple enough for the students to follow and reproduce, but at the same time it should be worthy or deep enough so that researchers are still interested in it. Now, a classic example I would like to give at this point is, maybe in a layman's language, I could write that 100% death was found or 100% death was perceived because of this research method. But in a more scientific way, I would like to communicate it better by saying that mortality was found to be 100%. So this gives a good scientific tone to what I'm trying to communicate. The next would be, you have to have effective ideas. And you need to use precise words to communicate that. Now, suppose if I were to give an example here, I would like to say that oral route has a plethora of advantages. Example, so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. in spite of all these advantages, we still see some challenges by oral route of administration, and we would like to explore alternate routes of administration. Now, this could be one way of putting it. This is not wrong. But if I have to make it more precise and I have to make it effectively communicated, I could maybe put it in a better way by saying that despite numerous advantages of the oral route, it still possesses some amount of administration challenges, such as so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. So I effectively communicate this long idea that I have to communicate, maybe in a complex but one sentence. So this makes it very easy for the readers. Needless to say, grammar, spelling, and punctuation have to be on point in whatever we are writing. The flow of thoughts between passages has to be so lucid and clear that there is no confusion. Like, a reader should not get lost when they are reading your paragraphs. So the idea essentially that started at my first para should clearly translate and get modified into the next thought in my second para, and then the next thought in the next para. So the flow of thoughts should be very uniform, and it should not, it should be a smooth transition. There should be constant notations throughout the text. Like, for example, if I use hours, if I use minutes, if I use grams in multiple part of the paper, somewhere my 5 grams should not be written as 5 gm, whereas in the other part my 10 grams should not be written as 10 g. So I need to ensure that there is uniformity of all these notations throughout my manuscript. And then coming to abbreviations, which would be stating or writing the full form of the abbreviation at the first time where it appears in the manuscript, for example, blood-brain barrier. So I mentioned blood-brain barrier at the first introduction, or maybe the first time where it appears in my manuscript, and write it in the bracket abbreviated as BBB. Now, my conscious effort for a uniform writing throughout the paper should be wherever I'm mentioning BBB, I should mention BBB instead of the blood-brain barrier. So this makes my writing very effective, good writing skills, and uniform. Chaitanya, I would like just like to rope you in and ask if everything is going smooth.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay. So now we finish with effective writing and we finish with good writing. These are the points that we need to remember throughout our scientific writing. Now we come to the main gist of this, why we are assembled today, that is writing publishable articles. For writing publishable articles, we have a set of prerequisites that we generally tend to avoid. So it is essential that we first put down a list of prerequisites. We form our article in such a way that our prerequisites are first satisfied, and then we move ahead to writing of the article. So the first very prerequisite of the article would be the originality of the article. Now, we know we have numerous research articles and review articles, book chapters, everything available on the public forum on multiple of subjects. So if our article has to be publishable, we need to make sure that there is certain amount of originality in the article that adds on information to the available literature. That's when you're considered as a good researcher and a good scientific writer, that your research has to add on some value to the available literature. The second point prerequisite would be reviewing your literature. Now here, I would like to talk about like the PhD students. Like, we generally take around, say, 5 years to finish our research. And by the end of, say, 2.5 or 3 years, we start writing our research paper because we have quite a sufficient amount of data by that time. Now the hitch that we face is, by the end of 3 years, you never know which research group at which part of the globe may have touched upon a similar article. If they touch upon the similar research article, we lose our novelty. Despite we have started it before, despite we are ready to write the article, but still we lose the advantage of being the first in that particular scientific area, because somebody else across the globe has already done it and published it. So we have to ensure that we are constantly up to date with the latest and updated review that comes across in the public forum. The next prerequisite would be to know your data well, which would allow you to decide what type of article you want to write. Is that a short article? Is that a full-length manuscript? Is that a review article? Is that an expert opinion on a particular article that you read? So unless and until you don't know what data you have, you can't decide the type of the article. And now based on this type of the article, you have to select your journal. Now this is most often the most ignored and the last selected part. Every journal has a particular scope that it is going to include. So it is going to accept your research article or review article only if you fit into that scope. Now, what according to our general think thought process, what we do is we write the article and then we try to, you know, fit into that journal scope. No, it doesn't work that way. You know the journal scope and you try to structure your article such that somewhere you try to fit into the journal scope. So journal selection is very mandatory, and based on the journal selection, you have their guides to authors, which is very specific to different journals. So if you know the guides to authors very well, that is, you know the referencing style, you know what is their, how is their subsection supposed to be, you know whether the results and discussions are together or the result is separate and the discussion is separate. So if you have this freehand idea, it will allow you to write your article in that particular format. And once you write it up according to a particular journal style, it is not difficult to change it to the others. But if you don't have any style in mind and if you write it freehand, then it is difficult to even structure it into a particular way. So it's highly recommended that your journal selection and guide to authors is really known well to you. And here I'm going to refer to this author guidelines multiple times because it is like the Bible when you are writing the writing your article. And the last time would be have sufficient time. You can't have a deadline of your guide telling you that, you know, when you're graduating, you need to have this article. If you do that, then I'm sure you're not going to have a good article. So you have sufficient, decent amount of time right from the draft version to the submission. And here I would especially like to address the postgraduate students by saying that, you know, when you're in the postgraduation level, we think that, you know, we can compile all the data later. But generally after say 6 to 8 months after you do your research, you generally forget and the importance of the method that you've used. So it is highly recommended for the students that you do a particular set of your research work. You document that research work into exactly what you have done, and the results that you achieve is highly preferable if you compile that results in a particular way which can be, you know, which is easily presentable. So suppose your guide asks you to show you your results tomorrow. Your results should be ready in such a format that it is easily understandable by your research guide. So the postgraduate students need to work on this so that, you know, your research and your documentation go hand in hand. And this will definitely be helpful for you in future for thesis writing as well as for your article writing. So now we come to the structure of a research article. So the structure of the research article essentially includes all of these, which we are going to touch subject by subject. So the first subject that we touch upon is the title. Title has to be attractive and motivating for the readers. Now, if I'm going to search something on the Science Direct, the first thing as a reader that is going to attract my attention is the title. So the title has to be informative, it has to be crisp and concise, and it has to also make sure that it covers the main objective of the manuscript. So one example of this while searching the research, while searching the literature that I got is this particular article, wherein the heading says complexity of dopamine metabolism. So if I read this article, if I even read the title, I very clearly understand that this author doesn't want to state or is not going to introduce about Parkinson's disease, or he's not going to talk upon the different neurotransmitters, or he's not explaining anything upon dopamine. But he has really explained what his gist is. And that just is what are the difficulties and complexity of dopamine metabolism. So this is how crisp and concise the title of your article should be. Sometimes this title is also known as the abstract of the abstract. So you have a main full-length article, you concise that into the abstract of the article, and you again concise this abstract to form the title. So one example of that could be, suppose if this is the title, So we cover all the main points in this, which says zero order release, cholecalciferol being the active ingredient. They form a microsphere type of a formulation system, and they have done their in vitro characterization and in vivo pharmacokinetic studies. So if I read this title, and if I am a researcher who is working on, say, microsphere technology, I sure is that this article is going to be helpful for me, and then I download this article to read it. Sometimes to make it more interesting, it is also framed as a question. But ultimately, however the title is framed, it has to be effective and it has to convey the entire gist of the article. The second topic that we touch is authors and affiliations. So the authors and affiliations, the author and the author order is very important when you draft a manuscript. And you have to ensure that the order of the authors is well settled right at the start. So this example that we are going to see ahead, I will explain about the author order and its importance. In recently, in scientific manuscript submissions, the publishing house has started asking for independent author contributions. That means there could be, to get the structure of the manuscript, there are multiple things that go into it. It could be right from conceptualizing the idea. It could be the actual methodology process. It could be the software that is used to interpret the results, or maybe data curation, or maybe somebody who's actually writing the original draft. Somebody will edit it, somebody will supervise it, or somebody will be responsible to acquire the fund for the scientific research. So all these can be the contributors to make your research article and make a contribution in the manuscript submission. So it is the duty that all of these contributors are given the authorship. And if their contribution doesn't rise to the level of authorship, they should at least be appropriately acknowledged in the manuscript. So the example that we are seeing here for authors and affiliations would be this. So in this particular article, you can see that there are six different authors. It is mandatory that in every article, the author names be consistent. Because if there is any difference in the initials or any difference in the order of the names, what happens is your articles under your name gets classified. So if you have two different or inconsistent names, you form two separate headings of your name and your article gets divided. So if I see Scopus for the list of authors, I need to, obviously everybody would need to find his entire article list under his name. So if you give inconsistent names about yourself or about your guide, then the list of the articles are going to get divided. The second importance is author order. So generally your first author is the author who has done maximum contribution to the research work or the research manuscript. So that could be the idea initiation, the idea inception, actual performing of the research articles, writing the draft manuscript. So whoever has a maximum contribution here would be ideally entitled to be the first author. The remaining authors are then depends on the amount of contribution they have made to the manuscript. And essentially the last author who has a star mark is the sole contact point, who is also called as the corresponding author. So this corresponding author is generally the higher senior faculty who is responsible for formal communication with the publishing house, with the editors, with the reviewers, and they are supposed to be always, their email ID is important and it is available in the public domain. So it also helps the readers, like me, if I have a doubt or I have to confirm something in this article, I'm going to connect to the corresponding author. So informally, the corresponding author is always the guide or the supervisor. And the third thing that we see are the affiliations. So affiliations could be multiple affiliations. There could be some collaborations between two organizations, and both the organizations are affiliated and acknowledged in the manuscript. Now we come to abstract. So abstract, you say, is a concise version of the entire manuscript. Now, if I'm searching something on ScienceDirect, what is the first thing that I read and decide whether I'm going to read the entire article or no? It is the abstract. So my abstract has to be extremely effective. It has to communicate all the important methods and results and implications of the findings. because this is going to attract me, whether I need to subscribe to the article, whether it is going to fulfill my research area, whether is this what I'm really looking forward to be a part of my research. So abstract is very important and has to be crafted very nicely. Generally, abstracts have word limitations, which is, you know, very journal dependent, and we need to abide by it. And references are avoided in the abstract. So now there are three different types of abstracts. One is the indicative or descriptive type. This used to be the case in abstract submission, and it is almost obsolete now. But this had a general format of a background of a main topic of the and the contents. The next type is an informative abstract. So in this informative abstract, the general method that is followed is the IMRAD style, which is called as the introduction, materials and methods, results and discussion. So you essentially don't have a heading, but you segregate your abstract such that you follow this IMRAD method. This is pretty common in pharma journals. And the third type of method is structured abstract, wherein you essentially have a heading, like you have a background, which is called as introduction. You have an objective aim, you have a materials and methods heading, and you put in your results in such particular heading. Now we come to graphical abstract. So this is a pretty new concept when you are submitting scientific manuscripts. Graphical abstract is a visual summary of the main findings. So it could be similar to the worded abstract, but it needs to be in a pictorial format. So all the important main materials, methods, the main results, implications could be put up in a form of a nice, eye-catchy and innovative graphical abstract. So your graphical abstract requires imagination, and there is no end to imagination. So there really can be good and innovative graphical abstracts that can come up with your research work. Some journals ask the graphical abstract to be submitted with or without a describing text, which is it is the specifications are as per journals. Chaitali, are we going good?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So these are the examples of graphical abstract. So from this graphical abstract, what we can see is it is self-explanatory. So we have a glycol chitosan, which self-assembles itself to form a carrier, which in the process encapsulates paclitaxel as the drug, and it forms a self-assembled carrier for paclitaxel, and there are some results what they have done. So this is similar to the worded abstract, but it just looks good and eye-catchy. This is another example where the author has tried to show an in silico simulation of a mucin and ligand. And he has tested this in silico simulation for ocular applications. And in that process, he is in ex vivo studies as well as in vivo studies. So if I have to, you know, if my research area or interest is in silico simulations, maybe for ocular applications, or if I'm trying to study something on mucin, I don't need to read the abstract. I can see this graphical abstract and immediately it strikes me, oh yeah, this is my research interest and I need to go ahead to read this article. So this is how, you know, the article can be made interesting by the help of graphical abstract. The next part that we come forward is to keywords. Keywords are specific and familiar words. Now, if I am the author of the manuscript, I need to write the keywords with the perspective of the reader or of the other research scientists who are going to search for my work. Like an example of this would be, if I am going to, my article is related to niosomes. So niosomes is a common word, but scientifically it is called non-ionic vesicles, non-ionic surfactant vesicles. So in spite my manuscript might contain non-ionic surfactant vesicles multiple times, but if I'm going to put non-ionic surfactant vesicles as my keywords, a general reader who's trying to develop his interest in niosomes will always search niosomes. So he will never reach to my article. And if I don't select appropriate keywords, I'm going to hamper the visibility of my own paper. So the keywords have to be always include key terminologies of your manuscript, and you need to make sure that you write it from a reader's perspective. Keywords, you should avoid abbreviations. And one very important thing in keywords is the keywords that you select should be sufficiently different from the title, because the main use of title as well as keywords go hand in hand in terms of separation of your art manuscript in terms of classification. So depending on the subject area, you have your title and your keywords are taken into consideration and they are classified. So if my keywords and title overlap, mean I just lose my advantage of, you know, classifying it into a better form. And the number of keywords varying as per journal guidelines. So an example that I found out here for good example of keywords would be the article title would be targeting the lymphatics using dendritic polymers. So essentially the author here is talking about dendrimers. So that would be one keyword. Lymphatic delivery is another keyword. So what they use is lymphatic transport. Obviously, when they are targeting the lymph through the dendrimers, it essentially means drug delivery is an important concept. In the entire article, they would have carried out pharmacokinetic study, bioavailability study. They would have used polymers and proteins. So to ensure that all these are available to the readers, the keywords have to be effective and it has to be the main terminologies used in your research, in your manuscript. So this encourages or this enhances your visibility to fellow researchers and to the students who are trying to read more about the research subject. Now we come to the very important and main topic of the research article, introduction. Introduction generally sets up the mood of the research paper. It is generally that which tells you the past, which tells you what is happening now, which tells you what you are going to do in the coming, say, multiple pages. So you need to have a very nice and placid way of writing this introduction. So introduction essentially contains a background of the study. You need to mention why is your study important and how different it is from the available literature. You need to touch upon the highlights and scope of improvement of the earlier literature. Then you mention, so then this introduction consists a large amount of, you know, relating to the previous available literature. What is the current future that you hold in sight for the manuscript? So this is the most vulnerable to plagiarism. So we need to be very sure that our introduction is written in such a nice manner that we minimize the plagiarism to the most. So we're going to talk about this plagiarism in the coming slides. This is where you could introduce yours a similar study that is carried out by your research group and relevant references in the introduction can be cited here. So now for writing the introduction, we adopt the funnel approach. So in this funnel approach, what happens is initially you state a wider problem statement. After the wider problem statement, you narrow down to come to what are your objectives. So from the wider problem, you come to what is the current knowledge that is available in the public forum. What is that current knowledge which you think is a lacuna to solve that particular problem that is currently present today? From that lacuna, you identify and you emphasize a little on that missing link between the which is leading to the therapy, because of which you construct your hypothesis based on that lacuna. And generally, the last 2-3 sentences of the introduction would be what is your primary outcome that you are expecting to get of your research work. So this is a general idea of the introduction that you need to follow. The next part is the materials and methods. So materials and methods is written with a clear intention that the fellow researchers or the students can reproduce your work. Reproduce your work in such a manner that they get similar results. Obviously, there will be lab to lab variances, there will be chemist to chemist variances. But despite all that, you have to ensure that they at least get similar results to what you have reported. Otherwise, either there is a lack of your scientific writing, either there is a lack of your scientific research knowledge, or it is the lack of the chemist who's trying to reproduce. So when we're looking at materials, you need to ensure that the material source is mentioned, the material grade is mentioned, which means the pH, which means the molecular weight, which means if it has a particular amount percentage deacetylation or acetylation, which is contributing to its main properties. So material, mentioning the material grade is very important. Another very important aspect here is you always acknowledge the company from where you've got a gift sample. Suppose here they say Rizomer, they have availed from Evonik. So it's essential you acknowledge this gift sample so that your research group and the company have a long-lasting and fruitful relation in the future. And also the common organic solvents that we use needs to be mentioned, like who's the supplier and who's the from which company do we arrange them. Then we come to the methods part of the manuscript. In this methods part, it is extremely straightforward. So it is exactly what you have performed in the research lab. You are trying to document it and write it in a scientific way. So the methods need to have a clear representation of what the exact the parameters or what is the exact process that you have followed. Now that includes surfactant concentration, that may include the temperature, the reaction time, the stirring speed, stirring time. It could also use the what software you have used to analyze the data that you have got. So if all these are clear, it will be just helpful to the fellow researcher to reproduce it in a way that you have reported. References of the methods must be mentioned. So an example that I've got that I've reported here is the solubility of the oil of the drug in the oils is reported here, and they follow the method that is reported somewhere as 24 reference. So you can easily write it as this method was followed as the procedure described elsewhere. Then comes the make of the instrument. So many a times generally the publishers ask you to mention the make of your instrument that you have used. So here the centrifugation has been performed by Remy India. So that has been mentioned here clearly. Now when you're writing the method, the language that goes into it should be formal and should be specific. So you tend to avoid ordinal languages. That would mean you just simply casually write, maybe you just try to write that first weigh so and so amount of drug, then add so and so ml of ethanol into that drug, weighed drug, and then you mix it, then you centrifuge it. So instead of that, this can be written in a better way, saying that briefly the method is explained as follows. At the outset or at initially, weigh 200 mg of lipids, into followed by adding 2 ml of ethanol. This could then be kept on centrifugation or say bath-sonicator to dissolve the drug. So this gives it a scientific and it gives a formal approach to the writing part. Often pictorial representation of the method may be helpful. So here the authors try to demonstrate the formation of microspheres by the single emulsion solvent evaporation method. So in the first step, they used an ultraterex homogenizer to make an oil in water emulsion, followed by the solvent. They evaporate the solvent because of which they get microspheres of say 10 to 60 micrometer, and then they filter it and then they freeze dry. So this could be one effective way of presenting your method that you have adopted. Now we talk about some special instruments have many parameters that have to work simultaneously to give you the required results. So when I'm talking about this means I'm talking about HPLC, because HPLC is one such instrument that we use to for somebody to reproduce this method. They exactly need all the knowledge of these parameters that could go right from the column type that you're using, the column specifications, what kind of detector you're using, what is the mobile phase composition along with the flow rate, the wavelength of detection and the injection volume. So if a person who's trying to reproduce this misses any of these parameters, he is not going to get reproducible results. So hence it is very essential to mention, to be very specific of writing what you have done and the results that you have acquired. Then we come to the results part of the this manuscript writing. Results means there has to be explicit mention of the quantitative and the qualitative results. When I say quantitative results, that means what is that microgram, nanogram per ml that has been estimated in the blood? What is that microgram per centimeter that is being permeated across a unit surface area, maybe through skin or maybe through nasal mucosa? Or when I talk about qualitative results, you have to mention that it is the there is significant uptake of your formulation. You essentially have to ensure that all the headings in the methods section, all those headings are covered under the results section. So maybe when you're writing, you could miss some minor points from the methods. So that is why whatever headings you are given as 7.1, 7.2, 7.3 in the methods section, you try to replicate it in the results section saying 8.1, 8.2, 8.3. So there is no scope of missing any result that you have performed, and there is no scope of missing the results of that method that you have performed. The results are generally reported in past tense, and it is always preferable, suppose there is comparison of two groups, so it is always preferable to use statistic measures to show whether they are statistically different or there is no statistical significance between the two groups. Now, an example that I want to explain here is, suppose we have two groups in animal studies. One would be the normal control group, one would be the disease-induced group. Obviously, for whatever parameter I'm trying to check, there has to be a statistic difference between the disease-induced group and the normal control group. This indicates that the disease is sufficiently induced in it. So how can I confidently say that there is a sufficient difference in the reading? This is, I can confidently say if I use statistics. If I use statistics and the p-value is less than 0.05, I can confidently say that there is a significant difference in both the readings. So this ensures that my disease-induced group has significantly different readings from my normal control group. And suppose if my treatment is effective, then I might not find a statistical difference between my treated groups and a normal control group. So statistics plays a very important role in giving confidence in the difference in results when you have multiple groups. So the results essentially have two particular subsections. One is the figure sections and one is the table sections. So in the figure section, it could include qualitative results like maybe a microscopy, histopath slides, or a fluorescent uptake studies, or it could be quantitative results like a chart or a pie gram or an histogram. It is necessary to cite all of these figures in text. So maybe if I am a reader who's reading the results of, say, plasma bioavailability, so I need to make sure. So if the author writes, so figure 7 shows the plasma bioavailability figure. So I know that I can immediately go to figure 7 and I can see that, oh, figure 7 links with this passage. So it is for the convenience of the readers. The captions must be self-sufficient to describe the figure. All the figure captions must be uniform throughout the paper, and the figures have to be high quality, which is the specifications of individual journals. The scale and the axis must be uniform along the paper, and the units must be mentioned specifically. This is one example of a qualitative result. This is an histopath slide which shows, and the caption is self-sufficient. The caption says histopathological studies of skin samples of A, untreated, and B, treated gel. So this ensures my qualitative result. This is an example of a quantitative result which shows a plasma concentration time curve of a formulation treated, and there are three groups. And it also says that the group size is n is equal to 6. So in this way, the figure caption is self-sufficient to describe the figure. Figures to differentiate the results of different groups. You may use different colors or different types of bars. The software that we can use for figures are GraphPad, Prism, or Origin. So what happens is when you're required to upload your figure, it needs to have a particular DPI, that is a particular resolution, which is generally more than 300 DPI for black and white figures. So if you use PowerPoint presentation or if you use Excel, the images that we download from Excel is not of high quality, it's not of 300 DPI. So it may initially pass through the reviewer round, but when it goes to the publication house and when it is actually seen in your paper, it will be very hazy. So to avoid that, what you do is you construct your figure. It's the GraphPad Prism is essentially similar to Excel, wherein you put in your data. There are cells like Excel. You put in your data, you can also have statistical analysis there, and you can construct your own figure, bar or bar chart, diagram, everything. So the image that you store and save is automatically of about 300 dpi. So this is one GraphPad Prism, and Origin is a little more complicated, but it is used for the same purpose. So this is what the diagram I was talking about, where you use different colors as a distinct markers, or you use different types of bars as a marker. Again, when we come to tables must convey information, but it must not be repetitive, as which is already shown in the figures. The table captions again must be self-explanatory, and it must be uniform throughout the article, and the units must be mentioned in the table. This is one example of table that I've taken from a published article. So it shows mean pharmacokinetic parameters and relative bioavailability in the brain tissue and plasma. And these are the various parameters along with units. And the table caption itself is self-sufficient to explain the entire table. Now we come to a very important part of the research article, which is the discussion part. Generally, discussion could be clubbed with results, forming one section called results and discussion, or sometimes it can be an altogether a different section called as discussion. Now, what is this discussion? Discussion is essentially interpretation of the results. All those questions for the all those answers for the question why and how have to be present in this discussion section. So suppose you obtain a result of, say, globule size to be 30 nanometer. Now 30 nanometer, you need to know why you have got this 30 nanometer as the particle size. So that justification of why 30 nanometer will be included in this discussion. That may be surfactant concentration, that may be surfactant efficacy, that could be low viscosity, that could be enhanced sonication time. So these are all the probable discussions as to why you have obtained that particle size, and it must be included in the discussion session. The discussion should also be written in connection with the hypothesis. So when you're writing the discussion, it is encouraged to again go through your introduction, read the hypothesis, understand the central idea, and then discuss your results in relation to the central idea. Now, one more point that in most of the research article it is missing is relation of different results. So now that we have one central idea, we have multiple results, and to form a meaningful discussion, we have to ensure that we connect all these multiple results to demonstrate a meaningful discussion. Now, like for example, I have enhanced bioavailability, which is also my hypothesis. So my hypothesis was to enhance the bioavailability by an alternate formulation. Now that formulation has a low particle size, it has mucoadhesivity, it has some amount of surfactant concentration, it has some formation enhancers in it. So for me to have a meaningful discussion to show that the enhanced the bioavailability, so I need to connect all these results that I've got. Like I need to show that the globule size is less, that could be there could be enhanced permeation, there is a permeation enhancer, so that could have helped in superior permeation. So I have to connect all these results to form a meaningful discussion. Now an example that I would take here is the first green box on the left hand side. So that says enhanced systemic absorption can be attributed to numerous reasons such as nanosize vesicle structure and favorable formulation components that play a role in enhancing the permeability across mucosal barriers. So this is a kind of discussion which is a compiled discussion of all the results that I've achieved. Now a very important part of this discussion is also to relate your discussion and your results to previously available literature that is available and that you must have referred of the similar topic, of course. So when you attain your results, there could be two things. Either your results will be supplementary to the past results, or your results may contradict the past results. Now, in both the cases, of course, if you are supplementing any previous available literature, there is less speculations, and you could easily say that the similar phenomena have been observed in the previous reports, and you can cite the references. But in case you have a contradictory results, that means you have done something differently, or there is some difference or some improvement in your results that is contradicting with the previously past available literature. So here you need to give in a little more justification as to why you think that you have obtained different results. So here you can say that on the contrary, our studies report something different. Our studies report that the enhancement of permeation is due to so-and-so reasons, and there is no apparent interaction between the formulation that what they have repaired, that what they have reported. Of course, this is not a critical review, but you need to just slightly touch upon points why you think that you have got contradicting results as compared to them. Please excuse me. Yeah. Now, another important point in this discussion is use of hedging language. However fulfilled or however complete we feel that our research is, we can never be 100% sure that we touch upon each and every subject. So instead of confidently stating some controversial topics like this is the only reason or this is the only known reason, instead of stating such bold statements, it is always recommended to use hedging language when you are writing the discussion. So this would give a benefit of doubt of you also playing a role in supplementing your previous research articles. So your hedging words could be, this might be because of so and so reason, or this potentially has the potential probable reason could be so and so, so and so. Your research work indicates or suggests so and so, so and so. So these hedging words are to be fixed when you are writing your discussion. Now we come to the conclusion part. The conclusion has to be positive in nature. You know that you cannot possibly cover the entire research structure. You cannot have possibly cover the entire research in that entire arena. So you know that there would be some limitations in your study. You need to be bold enough to acknowledge your limitations and turn that limitation into the future scope of maybe a reader who is reading your conclusion. So you need to put forward your conclusion positively, acknowledging the limitation, and you can use it that these could be the further scope in that particular research arena. And a conclusion is essentially different from an abstract or a summary. So in many research articles, what I have also come across is abstract is the conclusion is somewhat a modified version of the abstract. No, conclusion necessarily need not have any quantifiable amounts or any percentage enhancement in bioavailability or any thing that is quantitative in nature. It needs to have an overall superficial view of the entire results and discussion. So here the conclusion is very short and sweet. What they have just mentioned here is they have explored a new oligomeric nanoparticle to solubilize this paclitaxel drug that they have used as a model drug. They have not indicated any sort of results and discussion that they have got, like enhancement in permeability or enhancement in bioavailability. And at the end, they have suggested that this particular developed formulation has a higher potential as a new drug carrier of paclitaxel in cancer treatment. So this is how conclusion should be, an overall spotlight view of the entire conclusion, entire discussion and results that you have achieved in your paper. Now we come to acknowledgement. A scientific manuscript to form of that particular shape, numerous help is required, be it major or minor. That could be any help, like technical help, English language help, support in study, interpretation of results, or maybe just use an high-end instrument. So for all of these, they have to be acknowledged appropriately, either in the body of the text or in the final section of acknowledgement. Also, our scientific research, for us to carry on, we need some amount of money and funding. So it is very essential to also acknowledge the grant agency along with the number. So here is one snapshot of a published article wherein the author has acknowledged NIRH for providing them the facility of cryostat and confocal microscopy. The author has also rightly thanked the UGC, who has funded his particular research work or his particular stipend or the fellowship. Now we come to references. We are going to touch this references a little more in depth. References are all those articles or all those references that you have referred to make your own work. So essentially, it must follow a uniform style. And every journal suggests one particular referencing style. So you need to abide by that referencing style and make your referencing uniform throughout your article. To make it convenient for the readers, you could add the link or the DOI so that the readers can easily access that particular reference. And this referencing guideline is given in the author guidelines. Majority what happens is we take in a lot of data from the internet. We take in a lot of references from the internet, but internet is very dynamic. So whenever I'm referring something to that I've taken from the internet, access date is very important. So somebody understands that, okay, this might have been accessible till yesterday, but today when I'm searching, there is no access date. So the internet there is dynamic and that site must have been taken down. So access date for internet references is very important. And till my master's thesis, I had actually referenced it physically, but that is a very, very hell of a task. So referencing software is highly encouraged, like Mendeley, EndNote, Zotero, RefWorks. These are absolutely simple and very useful referencing tools that one must use when they are writing their thesis or writing their scientific manuscript. And the very easy advantage of this is they have a list of library of different styles that you can use. So you just put in that style which is given in your author guidelines, say Vancouver style. You put in Vancouver style, the in-text references also happen by Vancouver style. The bibliography list also comes by the Vancouver style. Access date is automatically taken because you're doing everything via software. So it's a very easy task, and everybody who's writing scientific data must be accustomed to these referencing softwares. And it goes without saying that excessive self or excessive your research group citations might not be the best way to refer to your work. This is one snapshot of the referencing wherein access dates have been provided by the author. Now the types of the referencing I was saying, one was this Vancouver style, wherein throughout the article, it is the references have been referred in brackets as numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Generally, a research article is expected to have anywhere around 30 to 50 references. And these appear in the bibliography in the order of appearance, say 1 to 50 or 1 to 30. Whereas the second style of referencing would be Harvard style. And in Harvard style, they do not use serial numbers, but they use the author surnames. So suppose these are the different authors and their date of publication. And when it comes to the references, they're referred as per their the alphabetical orders of their surnames. So this Alport, the first sentence is not necessarily the start of the sentence. It is somewhere in between the manuscript. But since his alphabetically he comes first, his name is at the start. Now we come to supplementary material. Now there are quite a few results which may not be absolutely important for the understanding of that particular research, but it could be of secondary importance and it could give a better understanding and deeper understanding to the readers. Like very very plain example, like somebody is talking about the microspheres of cholecalciferol, but I am going to make some other research formulation of cholecalciferol, and I would like to know more about the analysis method of cholecalciferol. So if that author has put up his analytical method development and validation in the supplementary material, it would help me. It would give me a deeper and a better understanding of the results. So somebody who is going to work on microsphere technology, for him the cholecalciferol analytical method development and validation may not make sense, but for me it is important. So all those results that you have performed and you think may be secondary could be added in the supplementary material. Similarly, as a graphical abstract that I explained about the simulation of the mucin and the ligand, so these simulation has videos to show the interaction between them. So these videos obviously cannot be uploaded in the written manuscript, and hence it is appended as a supplementary video. So these supplementary materials are available online and can be accessed online. In the first example, we have a supplementary document, whereas in the second online, you can access a supplementary video. Now we come to author declaration. So author declaration is a signed document by all the authors. You need to ensure that there is no conflict of interest in the particular research that you have done and you are trying to publish. This is an author declaration form that is given by Elsevier and may be required to be submitted for all the Elsevier journals. So here essentially it states that all the authors have read and approved the manuscript. All the authors are, the order of authors is acceptable to all the authors. The corresponding author is going to be the sole contact point for correspondence and for, you know, intimation of any further proceedings of the manuscript. No conflict of interest, no IP conflict, and these all have to be signed by all the authors. Now we come to order of preparation. So the order that we have discussed in writing a manuscript may not essentially be the order in which you prepare your manuscript. Preparation of manuscript may be different for different people, but in general, these are the structure that generally many researchers follow. So one would be the draft title. Title is very important, and it is actually difficult to, you know, form a title, to throw an impressive title. So you first make a draft title, then the author affiliations. Material and methods is pretty straightforward. You exactly document what you have done with all the specific parameters and all the other specific details. Depending on the materials and methods, you write the results that you have obtained. Results. Then you try to connect the discussion part with the results. Then you make a draft conclusion. Then what you do is, after writing all these, you try to write the introduction. Believe me, introduction is the most time-consuming. I would just request you to put off your audio. Thanks. Okay. So when we talk about writing the introduction, it is the most time-consuming job. It has the maximum amount of references. You need to paraphrase a lot of ideas that you read in multiple articles. So it's going to be time consuming, it's going to take a lot of your energy. So it is always advisable that you write all the straightforward things first, and then you come to the introduction, wherein you adopt that funnel approach to make the introduction. Then you go to the references. So generally introduction and references, bibliography go hand in hand. So as soon as you, you know, paraphrase a passage or you write an idea, and if you think you have picked this up from a particular reference, you immediately recite it by using Mendeley or EndNote or Zotero. Then after you do all this, you make the concise version of the abstract. From the abstract, you pick up the keywords. Then you write the acknowledgement supplementary material. And then you finally revise your title and conclusion as per the entire structure. So this is the general order of preparation which most of us follow. Now your job isn't done when you write the draft version. After the draft version, it is essential to revise the draft. And time and again, I always say that author guidelines is very important. Author guidelines gives you all the information that is required for you to submit a publishable article. You need to carefully read through and add additional data information. So you're writing the draft is just your first throw of information into writing that structured article. While revising, what you do is you carefully read through all the passages. If you think you've missed something, you add additional data. You think you're emphasizing a little too much on a particular idea, then you delete some data or make it concise. You improve basically the readability. If you think that there are some topics which you need to, you know, which looks a little cluttered, so you can split it and make it into highlight form. You either break up long complex sentences, or you combine multiple smaller sentences. Basically, you all do this to improve the readability. And then comes margin, fonts, font sizes, grammar, line numbers. Then it is also important to ask your colleagues to read through and incorporate suggestions, because what you have in your mind necessarily may not come out in your writing format. And in fact, in our PhD lab, we always, we help each other, we ask for each other's help. Seniors and colleagues suggest us important points that is required, because you and your guide may not be the you may not be able to convince or explain a particular point, and always different minds and numerous minds are always it makes a better impact on the manuscript. So, this is one very important stage in revising the draft. Now comes proofreading of the draft. In proofreading, again, you need to go through the author guidelines. And proofreading may be the last and the final step that you are in connection with your manuscript before you submit. So, you need to make sure that you very diligently proofread. So, even if you have not written properly in the first draft, but if you are proofreading it right and if you are making the right corrections, still again you have a chance of successful submission. This is what generally I do. I take multiple passes at my document. So if suppose I start from as somebody is on audio. Yeah, I'm actually getting a little disturbed. Yeah, thanks. This is what generally I do. I take multiple passes of the same document. So suppose my first focus point is numbering of the headings. So what I do is I start from page number 1 and go right up to page number 30 only to see uniformity of numbering. Then the next time I start from page number 1, now I'm only analyzing the font and the font sizes. I'm making sure that all my font is maybe Times New Roman, maybe all my font size is 12. So right from page number 1 to 30, I'm dedicating it completely to font and font size. So this gives me uniformity. The next time when I'm starting from page number 1, I am looking for margins and I'm looking for punctuation marks or maybe, you know, that red errors that Microsoft Word gives us because of spelling errors. So if I take multiple passes, I ensure that there is uniformity across my document. Another very important point in proofreading is tricking the brain. Now, if I am going to read my document 10 times on the soft copy, I am not going to find out any errors in it because my brain is supporting it. Because I have written it, so my brain is supporting it with me with the missing links. But if I read my soft copy 2 times and if I'm going to take a hard copy and maybe underline it and read it, I am sure to find out maximum mistakes that I would have missed it in the soft copy. So this is very essential in proofreading because you are trying to give it a different route of thinking. So for this, you need to have time. You need to have patience to go through the same document in different ways. You need to double check the names and figures because you definitely don't want to misspell your guide's name or you don't want to misspell the editor's name or even for that matter, even your own name. So double checking the names and figures are very important. And you need to have ample time for reruns. Allow fresh thoughts to get into your mind after one proofread. So after one proofread, maybe if you give a gap of 2 days, not seeing the document at all, and on the third day, you will have fresh thoughts to, you know, improve your manuscript. And hence, I think ample time is the key to proofread it very effectively. Now we've seen about writing it and proofreading it. Now we are also looking at submitting it and revising it. So for submission, the first step is uploading all the documents that is required by the journal. And that the checklist would be a cover letter, the highlights, graphical abstract, manuscript, tables and figures, potential reviewers or supplementary files that is required to go in the along with the manuscript. After you upload all these documents, there is a proofreading PDF version that is built up by the site itself. You proofread through this PDF version to ensure that there is no technical glitches, like there is no missing of any table number, figure number, or there is no splitting of any table across 2 pages. In that case, you go back to the manuscript, change some spacing errors, and then come back to this proofreading PDF version and submit the final submission. Then you wait for the editorial responses, which says the status says either it is with the editor or it is under review. So when you say it is with the editor is looking at the overall look and feel of the manuscript and he is deciding whether it is this manuscript can be considered for his particular journal. And if he feels it is particular, then he sends it across to the reviewers and the status changes to under review. Now after reviewing, there is a decision process. This decision could either be a revision, which could be a major revision or a minor revision, or it could be a rejection. Now, essentially, while revising it, they pick up some queries in your manuscript, and that comes to you as queries by the reviewers. When you are uploading it, you have to respond to these queries in a separate Word document and you have to make sure that all these responses have been incorporated in your manuscript, and then you submit an edited manuscript. After you upload the edited manuscript, there could or could not be a second round of revision, which will be obviously minor because you've covered all the major points. Again, you re-upload it and there will be an edited manuscript to go along. Finally, there will be a proofread, a galley proof of your final article, and then it goes to the production process to publish your manuscript. Now, when I say that if I am an editor of a particular journal, what do I see when you submit your, when your article comes to me, when your manuscript comes to me, what is it that I am looking for? So I have to keep up the name of the journal. So I am definitely going to see if your research subject fits into the scope of my journal. So if it is out of scope of submission, I'm not going to go for any other criteria, and I'm directly going to send you a response saying that it is out of scope of the journal. And hence, I would like to reinstate here that scope of the journal selection is very essential right at the start, even before you structure your manuscript. The second thing comes that your research article might not be contributing to any novelty in the particular area that is already known, or may not improve the readership quality. So based on this, the editor might reject your article. The editor also sees to the formatting of the paper. Is it as per the journal guidelines? Have you suggested appropriate reviewers? Have you adequately responded to the reviewers if this is a re-upload of yours? Do you have fluency in English language, or is there a lot of plagiarism in your manuscript? If he's satisfied with all this, then he is going to push your article to the reviewers. If he's not satisfied with all these, and if he doesn't think that your article is going to improve the overall readership quality of his particular journal, I'm afraid he might have to reject your article. Now, when you're these are the checklists that we already mentioned. So in the cover letter, you need to mention the editor name and the journal name. You need to ensure that you specify the novelty, the originality of your research findings, what are the core findings, and what are the importance of the reading. Now, when you send across your manuscript, the first thing that is going to come along with the manuscript to the editor is a cover letter. So I, even before reading your abstract or your title, I am reading your cover letter. So in your cover letter, you have to convince me that your research work is original, there is sufficient novelty, and that is going to improve the readership quality of your particular journal. And it is very important to state these two sentences, that all authors must have approved of the manuscript, and this submission is not submitted elsewhere simultaneously. So these are the two things that clearly, explicitly needs to be mentioned in the cover letter. The journal also asks for you to suggest potential reviewers. This could be so that the reviewer's expertise matches to your paper topic. The general suggested reviewers, it is highly encouraged if they could be of global preference, so that that shows sufficient confidence of you that you are okay, ready. Even a global reviewer comes to review your article, you are sufficiently ready, and that shows your confidence. Of course, the reviewers should not be your supervisors or any close connections, and they must not be be directly related to your subject area. Now, after it qualifies all the editorial categories, the editor selects shortlist some reviewers. These reviewers accept voluntarily to review your article. So when the article comes to the reviewer is majorly looking at these 5 points. So reviewer is basically the technical round of your job interview. So this is the technical round. So in this reviewer, the reviewer sees the paper abstract. He sees the first impression based on which he decides to review or no. Once he accepts, then he reads the paper objectives. The abstract and the introduction should be able to satisfy him. Then he looks at the conclusion. What is the take-home message, and what the future holds in that area? Then he looks at the length of the paper. Is this length of the paper really necessary to convey this hypothesis and to conclude with their results? And what are the references? Like, is it up to date? Is he mentioning maybe a 2020 paper, or he's still stuck to some 2013-2012 article? So with all these points, he's able to gauge and weigh your article. Now, depending on all these, if he thinks it's convincing, he's going to review your paper, and the reviewer is going to pick out some essential queries. Now, as an author, when it comes back to you as queries, it is your responsibility to diligently respond to all these queries. So in your response to the queries of reviewers, you need to be polite and respectful, because they are the ones who are voluntarily reviewing your paper. So you need to be utmost polite and respectful when you're giving away the answers. The answers must not beat around the bush. The reviewer has picked out a specific query. You need to be very specific and precise while explaining your answers. You have to, different reviewers, there could be two, there could be three reviewers, and each reviewer might have 2 points, might have 15 points. So you have to ensure that all the reviewers' comments are addressed point by point. This is completely at the discretion. I'm really not a person to say this, but sometimes when you think that the reviewer's suggestions is not what it seems to be, or it is not the main idea of what you are trying to put forth, it is okay sometimes to not incorporate the reviewer's suggestions, provided you give appropriate and good justifications as to why you are not doing so. So this is completely at the discretion, and it is very subjective to that particular matter. And again, changes in the manuscripts that you make or the incorporations that you make must be track changed on Word or must be highlighted, so that it is a convenience for the reviewers to, you know, go back and check the manuscript. This is one example of a response to queries. So here they thank the reviewers. They assure about the changes that they have made in the manuscript. They address the comments point wise in the following section. Track change or highlights have been made, and relevant references, wherever they have justified the query, they have added relevant references to justify their response. Now, this is the last section that we're going to target, and this is a very important section, which is publishing offenses. So a lot of us think that plagiarism is okay, like, you know, it is manageable. Actually, it's not. In fact, in the last year, there have been a lot of good publishing houses saying that this plagiarism has gone unnoticed and all these good articles have been published. This is, plagiarism is a publishing offense. So the guide as well as the student has to equally ensure that this is not overseen. Plagiarism is actually defined as an intentional or unintentional copying of the words or thoughts or intentions of the other person. So generally what we do is we read a lot of data. We have a lot of data in our mind. But if we are writing this data without giving credits to them, then it accounts for plagiarism. Maybe you could paraphrase it and give due credits to them. Then it might not be considered as plagiarism, because you have somebody to give credit to and you don't claim that it is your own. So plagiarism could be direct plagiarism, that is plagiarism of the entire text, mosaic, that is borrowing ideas and opinions, and could be self-plagiarism, that is you're reusing the figures and tables of your own work without saying that it has been already published or without citing it. The software that can be used for plagiarism is Authenticate, UniCheck, Grammarly. So paid versions generally give you a better and you know, reliable results. The similarity factor is very dependent from journal to journal, but less than 30% is generally acceptable. And again, plagiarism is a serious academic offense for the authors as well as guide, because it can irreversibly tarnish your name in the research scientific community. So this is an Authenticate report that I'm putting forward. So this, the highlighted things, gives you the similarity to that particular reference. And the report says 24% similarity, which is acceptable by most of the journals. Other publishing offenses would be multiple submissions, that you submit the same article at the same time to multiple publishing houses. It could be resubmission, that is you resubmit the same article without changes, maybe in a cover span of 2 months. Data fabrication, that is Excel making of data. Data falsification, that is you are getting some other data and you are falsifying some other data. So with this, I would like to conclude this webinar, which is best writing practices in the scientific terms. And I hope you have understood this well. I hope you can use the remaining days of quarantine to, you know, start writing scientifically. So this is my email ID. So if there is anything you need to get across or communicate, I will be open to take up emails. And you could post any of questions that you have on the chat section. Chaitali, depending on the time that we have, she's going to pick up a couple of questions and we could answer that. Thank you very much for your time and attention. Thank you, Chaitali.
Thank you, Sita. The session was very informative. I'm sure we all have learned something new today. And you have mostly covered everything in your slides. Still, we have some time to take a couple of questions. So I'll just read the questions for you.
Yeah.
So they are asking, can you tell some tips to minimize plagiarism while writing review articles, since the information isn't new and simply a compilation of data?
Okay, so this is a very good question. So essentially to reduce plagiarism, what generally you are supposed to ideally do is read all the articles while writing. Do not refer to any written part. While writing, put in your own thoughts. Write with your ideas, write with your knowledge. Because if you refer to the articles that is already published, unknowingly you get the same tone, you get the same the writing words, you get the same flow of thoughts. So it is preferable that you first read the articles, assimilate everything in your mind, and then put it into words. For figures, for numbers, for percent bioavailability, for such numerical terms, there is no escaping away. So some amount of plagiarism is going to be going to come. But you always make sure that you refer everybody, everything that you have mentioned in your research article must be cited. So that will reduce your plagiarism.
Okay. Then there's another question that says, can we submit the same article to another publisher if it is rejected by the previous publisher?
Yes, of course. So you have to make sure that you get it rejected or you get it approved by that particular publisher. Simultaneous publication is an offense, which I don't know if people do, but if they do, they do it to save time. So if they're simultaneously submitting it to different editors, there might be a quick response, there might be a delayed response. But simultaneous publication is an offense, and that is why they clearly ask you to mention in your cover letter that this has not been simultaneously considered in any other journal. So you can of course submit it once it has been rejected.
Okay. Thank you so much, Sita. I think all other questions you have addressed in your presentation. If they have any specific doubt, they can write to you, right?
Yeah, definitely. My email ID is sita.vd@gmail.com, and I will be available to take any questions on email.
Sita, this is again Dr. Supriya, and thank you so much, Sita. Your presentation was really very elaborate. You have started from writing of article, and then you have touched upon proofreading, submission, uploading, editor's view, reviewer's view, how to respond to it, and also offenses in plagiarism. That was really a very holistic journey to go for a good publication. Couple of doubts that are there in my mind. Is it possible that you have a corresponding author shared between two authors?
No, ma'am. Actually, corresponding author is generally just one author. So this is for simplicity of correspondence between the publishing house and between the editors. So it is generally first author can be shared if they have equal contributions, but corresponding author is generally just one author.
Okay. And another doubt that many students ask, whether they can take a figure directly from any published article.
Okay, so if you are taking a direct figure from any published article, you need to actually write to that author and ask him if you can reproduce his results, you can reproduce his figure, and if he gives an acceptance, then write below the figure caption, you put into the bracket, reproduce with permission from so-and-so et al.
You must take the permission.
Yes, you need to take the permission and you need to appropriately cite it. Without taking permission, if you cite it, that is also not right. And only if you don't ask him the permission and if you don't cite, then that is clear-cut plagiarism.
Okay. Thank you, Sita.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Really a very nice presentation. And I'm sure all the audience, they will agree with me that you have made our journey very easy and you have given it with lot of, entire explanation was given with lot of examples. So here I can see my colleagues, senior teachers, all the faculty members, and I'm really glad that everyone has attended this seminar, and I'm sure everybody had something to take away. So thank you, Sita. Thanks a lot. And I must acknowledge that the second session, which was live, was also delivered with equal effectiveness, and you have not missed even the slightest 0.01% point that you elaborated in the first session. So that's so kind of you. That shows the passion to reach out to the to your juniors with, and also to all those who wish to go for good scientific writing. Thank you so much. So
thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
That's our pleasure. So Chaitali, now can you conclude on session? If you want to share or you want to give some instructions, you can give.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, it's just a small instruction to all the participants. Shortly, I'll be sharing a feedback form with you all, those who have registered. Please fill the feedback form so that you can get your e-certificate for attending the webinar. Also, I request that please switch on your videos so that we can take a nice photograph of all of you. Just a second, I'll just click. Sir, can you stop sharing your presentation?
Yes, please. Done.
Thank you. So I'm clicking the photo. Everyone, smile, please. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So we have come to the end of this webinar. Please fill the feedback form so that we know your views on the webinar. Thank you so much. Have a good day. Bye.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.
Thank you. Thanks, Sita. Bye, Anna.
Bye, ma'am. Bye.